Now let's take our Bibles and turn to the Gospel of John this morning, to the 15th chapter. I'm going to change the text and the message from what you have in the bulletin and wait till next Sunday to begin the series on the Lord's Supper. But what I would like to do today is to look at this passage of Scripture in John chapter 15. And in the opening verses of this passage of Scripture, we have a foundation for praying. And I think this foundation is necessary for us to really understand what the Lord is teaching us when we get to the Lord's Prayer next Sunday morning. So let's look at John chapter 15. If you'll stand with me to honor the Word of God. And we're going to read beginning in verse 1. These are the words of Jesus. Jesus said, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered, and they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned." Now I want you to watch verse 7. This is the key verse. Jesus said, "If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you." Now, we're thinking about a foundation for praying. I want you to look at verse 7 again. Look at what it says. Jesus said, "If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you." Now, we believe that. Amen? Amen. And Jesus said that, and we can count on that. So let's look at this and see how we can have a foundation to our praying as we begin to pray the Lord's Prayer, to abide in him and let his word abide in us, so that when we pray, our prayers will be answered. Father, may the Spirit of God teach us today and help lay in our hearts a foundation for praying in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen. Thank you. Please be seated. More than likely, all of us have had an experience where we have prayed about something and God did not answer, or at least he did not answer in the way that we thought he would. Maybe he answered in a different way than we wanted him to. But did you know that in Scripture, God does not promise to answer everyone's prayers? Did you know that? God does not promise to do that. And it's very clear in God's Word that he has laid out some conditions here, some conditions to answered prayer. And I want you to look back at verse 7 again. Notice carefully what Jesus said, "If you abide," and that's the key, abiding in Jesus. "If you abide in me and my word abides in you, you will ask what you desire and it shall be done unto you." So what does it mean to abide in him, to let his word abide in us, so that when we ask what we desire and we know we're abiding in him, then Jesus says, "I will answer your prayers." So I want you to think with me about several things this morning, and this is a foundation for praying. Number one, Scripture teaches us here that in order to have our prayers answered, we must have right fellowship with God. Right fellowship with God. That's what Jesus is saying in verse 7. He's talking about abiding in him. We must abide in him. His word must abide in us. Now, that's talking about fellowship. We have to have a fellowship with God where we're abiding in Him and His word is abiding in us. And so we have to answer some questions. How can we be abiding with Jesus when we have anything in our life that we have not confessed to Him? You see what I mean? How can we say that we're abiding in Jesus when we're hiding some secret sin in our heart that we've not confessed to God? So I want to ask you this question. Is there at this moment in your life anything that the Spirit of God brings to your heart that you need to ask God for forgiveness? Is there anything in your life that the Holy Spirit convicts you? Because that keeps us from abiding with Him. And now that does not destroy our relationship with Jesus, but it does destroy our fellowship with Jesus. And there's a big difference between having a relationship and having a fellowship with Him. And Scripture tells us that our unconfessed sin will keep God from answering our prayers. Now you may say, well, Pastor, I've carried unconfessed sin in my heart for years and God answers my prayers. No, He doesn't. Somebody else is praying for you and He's answering their prayers. But He's not answering your prayers because God will not. He says we have to abide in Him. His word must abide in us. And the only thing that, the first thing we have to do before we can abide in Him is make sure that we have confessed our sins to Him. Psalm 66:18 says that if we regard sin, if we cherish sin in our heart, the Lord will not hear us. Proverbs 28:13 reminds us that if we try to hide our sin or cover our sin, we will not prosper. So what do we do if our prayers are not being answered? Well, the first thing to do is search our heart and make sure that our fellowship with God does not need to be repaired, to ask God to reveal any sin in our life that we have failed to confess. 1 John 1:9 is a beautiful verse. It says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You see, God's just waiting on you and me. God's just waiting on us. Now, what is confession? We talk about confession of sin, but what is confession? Confession is simply being honest with God. Confession is saying, God, you're right and I'm wrong. That's what confession is. Confession is saying, God, you're right, I'm wrong, I sinned, please forgive me. And when you do that, 1 John tells us that He's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It's not that God cannot cleanse sin and cannot forgive sin. It's so often that because of pride in our hearts, we're not confessing it to Him. And so we can't abide with Jesus until we're clean with Jesus. So I want to ask you that question again. Is there anything in your heart this morning, anything that the Spirit of God takes you by the hand and walks you to this morning and says to you in your heart, this is something that you need to deal with if you really want to abide with me? Now, if the Holy Spirit does that, you need to deal with that this morning. If you're understanding me, say amen. So that's confession. And when God tells us to do something, that's what we need to do. Have you ever told your small child to go clean up her room and 30 minutes later you go in and the room is half picked up and she's still got things all over the floor, but she's 4 years old? Now, you would not expect a 4-year-old child to clean up her room or his room the way that you might clean it up as an adult. But you'd go in there and you would see that he or she tried the best they could. The room is not perfect, but they did the best they could. But what if you have a 16-year-old and you tell the 16-year-old to go in and clean up his room or her room? Sometimes you just want to give up, don't you? But you tell them to go in and clean up their room, and then you go in a half an hour later and nothing's been done and they're still watching TV. Do you get upset? Well, you should. You should get upset because as a parent, you expect that child, that 16-year-old child, to do a better job than the 4-year-old child did. And so the Bible teaches us the same. God expects obedience in our life. And as Christians and mature believers, God expects us to have an attitude where we want to do what is right. Not an attitude of habitually sinning, not an attitude of being rebellious against God and sinning. So we ask, God, is there any unconfessed sin in my heart? Am I currently ignoring any of your word? And I'll tell you what, if you ask God that, God's going to answer that question. And God will walk you right back to it. And you can get it right with him. Here's another question. Do I really want God's will for my life? Do I really want God's will for my life? You see, sometimes we say, yes, I really want God's will for my life until God says, okay, here's my will for your life. And you say, well, God, I'm not going to do that. Do we really want God's will for our life? 1 John 5:14 says, now, this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears it. According to his will. You see, if you want to have confidence in prayer, you have to pray according to the will of God. Now, how do you do that? You abide in Jesus. You let his word abide in you. Sometimes as Christians, we approach prayer in a way that is counter to what God teaches in his word. Sometimes we will pray, God, if it is your will, I will ask for this. Or, God, is it your will that I should ask for this? But the real issue, if you stop and think about it, the real issue is, am I in God's will as a person? Am I in the will of God as a person? You see, if my life is in harmony with God, if your life is in harmony with God, if we are abiding in Jesus and Jesus, the Word, is abiding in us, then we're living in the will of God. And when we're living in the will of God, we don't have to wonder if something's God's will. We're going to desire what God desires if we're living in his will. And that's why Jesus' prayers were answered, because Jesus lived in the will of the Father. Jesus prayed in the will of the Father. And so that's what God wants us to do. So we have to have a right fellowship with God. Number two, this is a foundation for praying. Number two, we have to have real forgiveness. Real forgiveness. Now, not everybody may forgive us, but if we're going to pray and have our prayers answered, we have to forgive everybody. And in Mark 11:25, Jesus talks about answered prayer. And listen to what he says. And whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive him, that your Father in heaven may also forgive you your trespasses. That's talking about real forgiveness. And we're going to see when we begin to get into the Lord's Prayer that this is a prerequisite for having our prayers answered. Nothing will kill our prayers faster than resentment and bitterness. Amen? That was kind of weak, folks. But this is true. And I want you to stop and think about this. When we hold a grudge, when we nurse an ill feeling, when we allow bitterness to grow in our heart. Now, and I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, you don't know what they did to me. Well, listen, God knows what they did to you. And God expects us to forgive them. They may never forgive us, but God expects us to forgive them if we're going to have our prayers answered. And one of the primary reasons that many people never see answers to their prayer is because they allow bitterness to spring up in their life and they hold on to it. And it chokes out their prayer life. So when we pray, we pray in the Lord's Prayer, Father, forgive us our what? Our trespasses. And then we say, forgive us as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. Think about what that means. That means that we are to forgive others, that it has to be a real forgiveness when we pray. Right fellowship, real forgiveness. Here's the third foundation, and that's reliable faith. Reliable faith. I want you to turn for a moment over to the book of James and look at chapter 1. James chapter 1. And look with me at verses 6 and 7. Now I'm going to wait a minute. I want you to turn and look at this with me. James chapter 1, verses 6 and 7. And this is talking about reliable faith. And that's a foundation now for our prayers being answered. James chapter 1, verse 6. But let him ask in faith with no doubting, for he who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. And then look at verse 7. Look at what it says. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. Now it's talking in this particular passage about wisdom, praying for wisdom, but the principle applies to whatever we're praying for. It's transferable. And God is teaching us here that when we pray, we are to pray in faith and not waver. We're to pray believing. That is a reliable faith. And there's only one kind of prayer that God answers, and that's the prayer of faith. In Mark 9:23, and I love this passage of Scripture, Jesus said, if you can believe, all things are possible to him that believes. If you can believe, all things are possible to him that believes. In Hebrews 11:6, the Bible says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. I think that's why in Ephesians, where Scripture talks about putting on the armor of God that we wear every day for protection in our battle against the evil one, there is the shield of faith. And every day as we put that shield of faith on, we need to be praying the same prayer the man prayed in the New Testament. We need to be praying for God to increase our faith. When I pray, I say, God, I want a reliable faith. If I don't have enough faith, increase my faith so through my faith you will be able to hear and answer prayer. Sometimes we just need to have that kind of faith. The guy in the Bible didn't have it. He said, God, increase my faith. And so maybe that's a prayer that some of us need to pray today. If you've got a tremendous desire, you've got goals you're praying about, maybe family issues you're praying about, spiritual things, financial health issues, and you really have a desire, you really have a desire for these things, and you're praying because you have that desire. But desire is not faith. And sometimes we confuse the two. Desire can lead to faith, but desire is not faith. There's a difference between the two. The Bible says, according to your faith. Now listen to this. Not according to your ability, not according to your education, not according to how good a person you are, but according to your faith, it shall be done unto you. Right fellowship, real forgiveness, reliable faith. And the fact is, if we can meet these conditions of Scripture, we have every right to expect Jesus to answer our prayers. If you take a seed and you plant your seed in the ground and it begins to sprout and you get a tomato from it, you know why you got that tomato? It's because you cooperated with the laws of the universe that God set in nature and it happened. And the same thing happens spiritually to us. When we cooperate with God's laws in His Word, we begin to live them and apply them. We are abiding in Christ, and His words abide in us. We're living His Word day by day. We're living these principles in the Word of God, and then God says He'll answer our prayers. I read about a man who took his son and 14 of his son's friends to the carnival for a birthday party. He bought a roll of tickets and he stood at the front of every ride, and as kids came by with his son, he would hand out the tickets. So he was standing there handing them out at one of these rides. And all of a sudden he looked up and he realized there was a little boy with his hand out asking for a ticket that he didn't bring with him, that he'd never seen before in his life. And so he stopped and he said, are you with my son's birthday party? He said, no. And he said to the little boy, well, why should I give you a ticket? And the little boy turned and pointed to the man's son and he said, your son said to give me one. Now, he got a ticket because his son said he could have one. Now, here's my point. You see, what makes me think that I should get my prayers answered? What right do I have for Holy God to answer my prayers? None. Nothing at all. It is only because I go through His Son that my prayers can be answered. It is only when we go through the Lord Jesus. We don't ask on our own merit. We come to Christ and we say, Father, I'm coming to you in prayer today because your Son said so. I'm coming to you today because of what your Son has already done. He's promised that if I abide in Him and His words abide in me, that I can ask whatever I desire and you will do it. Now, do you believe that? Amen? I believe that. You see, Jesus is the bridge between God and man. God came in the form of a man, the Lord Jesus, and the Bible says there is one mediator, one bridge between God and man. Jesus said it like this. He said, I am the way. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus is the bridge to God. Now, has there been a time in your life when you've invited Jesus to save you? When you've invited Jesus to come into your heart and life and save you? Have you received the Son of God into your heart and life as your Savior? He's the bridge to heaven. He's the only way to heaven. And you will not, and I want you to listen to me, you absolutely will not go to heaven unless you go through Jesus Christ. You will not. And you say, well, I don't believe that. And I would say to you, it doesn't matter whether you believe it or not. It's true. And if you want to gamble with your soul, walk out of here without believing it, and you'll find out. And we don't want you to find out that way. We want you to accept Jesus. Jesus wants you to accept Him, to turn from your sin, to give your life to Him. Here and in the Christian Life Center this morning, if there's one person that has not given their life to Jesus, don't you want to go to heaven when you die? Don't you want to be with Jesus for all eternity? Then you need to give your life to Him. And as we stand and sing, we ask you to come, and our pastors will be here to receive you. You come as we sing.